علمتنا فعلمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا كريم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقده من لساني يفقهوا قولي. My dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So I was asked to speak about family relations in Islam, and I think the best way to speak about this is to firstly start out with an athar of Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, and then I'm going to share my personal story with my parents with you, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. You guys are in for a bit of a roller coaster ride. So there was a man during the time of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhumah whose father had passed away, and he was the second parent that had passed away. So Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhumah came to give condolences to this man, and he says, "I'm so sorry for your loss. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him Jannah and forgive him and make things easy for your family." And he gives his condolences, and this man just profusely starts crying and crying and crying. And then Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, he tells him that, "Look, don't worry, he's gone to a better place. You don't need to cry so much. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take care of him." And Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhumah was shocked by what this man said to him. This man said, "I'm not crying because my parents have passed away. I'm crying because my middle gate to Jannah has now closed. My middle gate to Jannah has now closed." And subhanAllah, I think about this narration a lot, because how many of us perceive our parents as our middle gate to Jannah? Right? When you look at your parents, do you see your middle gate to Jannah in them? Or do you just view them as your parents? And this is a mindset that needs to be shifted, that when you look at your parents, you literally need to see your middle gate of Jannah in front of them. That any harm that you do, you're putting a barrier between yourself and this middle gate of Jannah. So now, let's speak about my parents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon both of them and forgive them. So alhamdulillah, I was fortunate to study at the Islamic University of Medina, and I was a broke student. I had absolutely no money whatsoever. In fact, till that day, I had never worked a job at all in my life. My parents, you know, always had this thing of study, 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 study. So when I got to Medina University, my father, rahimahullah, funded my whole entire education, anything that I needed, no joke. Anything that I needed, he's like, "Bismillah, you know, just let me know and I'll take care of it." And he was the most generous of men, not only with me, but whoever he interacted with. And I always had this dream that, you know what, when I graduate from the Islamic University of Medina and when I start working, I'm going to pay my dad back for every single penny that he gave me and he supported me with. And subhanAllah, it was the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that my father, rahimahullah, passed away before I could even come close to doing that. And I want to share that story with you. So in 2012, I moved from Montreal to Calgary because that's where the imam job was that I got. And my parents, rahimahumullah, they stayed in Montreal. But I would call them every single day. I would visit them, if not every month, every second month, try to at least go spend a weekend with them. And that is how the relationship continued. And then towards the end of my father's life, rahimahullah, in 2019, he got very sick. He was in and out of the hospital. And I told myself that, you know what, I'm going to be an obedient son. And inshallah, when his final moments come, I'm going to be there by his side. And subhanAllah, it just so happened that on September 3rd, I had just come back, I want to say from Umrah at that time, maybe like 2 days before. And I told him, "Dad, look, I came back. I'm not feeling too well, but I still want to come and see you. Like, I can't wait to see you." And he's like, "Navaid, you know what? Just stay in Calgary. And inshallah, when you feel better, you can come then." This was probably around 3 p.m. The next morning at 8 a.m., I was actually outside of the city on my way to Edmonton. When my mother, rahimahullah, she called me. She's like, "Navaid, come back. Your father's in the hospital now, and it's very, very serious." So I kept making dua, I'm like, "Oh Allah, you know, protect him. Just keep him alive till I get there, right? Just keep him alive. I want to be there for his final moments. I want to be able to recite Surah Yasin, you know, recite the Shahada, do whatever I could, like whatever a righteous son would be." And subhanAllah, it was the will of Allah. I arrived probably at 3 p.m. in the afternoon. I took the first flight that I could, but he had passed away by 11 a.m. at that time. And since that day, I lived with regret. I thought to myself, SubhanAllah, what is the point of all this knowledge that you learn? What is the point of all the da'wah that we do if you can't be there for your parents in your final moments? Alhamdulillah, I got to do his ghusl, I got to lead his janazah, but it left a pain in my heart that you can't take away, SubhanAllah. That your parents, they do everything for you, and SubhanAllah, you can't even be there for them in your final moments. I mean, this is a part of reconciling the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best of planners and He knows how everything is going to play out. But it left a darkness on my heart at the very least. Now, where's the good that came out of this? The good that came out of this, I was determined, you know, no matter what happens, that when my mother's time comes, I'm going to be by her side. And it's a fascinating story, subhanAllah. Since I moved in 2012, every year we would almost have a fight in my house. Mom, Dad, please come and move to Calgary with me. This is where my job is. You guys have no one left in Montreal. Why are you staying in Montreal? But all their friends were there. The masjid was there. Their doctors were there. And they were set in their ways. But subhanAllah, when my father passed away, you know, one of my du'as came true, which was my mother moved to Calgary this time. And alhamdulillah, I got to take care of her. But what happened? My father passed away in September of 2019. My mother moves with me in December of 2019. And March of 2020, the pandemic struck. Everything shut down. And subhanAllah, you know, for some people, the pandemic was catastrophic. It was so difficult to navigate, so difficult to go through. But for me, I'm like, Allahu Akbar, my dream came true. You know, I was away from my parents for 7.5 years in Medina. But now my mom's living with me. And I was making dua for this for so long. And I was over the moon. And subhanAllah, as a joke, I say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused the pandemic to happen at the perfect time so that my mother would be stuck with me. And I got to spend that time with her. But she grew older. And this is such a fascinating relationship, subhanAllah. Like, I'm not sure what your parents' relationships are like with one another. But my parents had this very fascinating relationship. When they were with each other, they're always fighting. Not like a serious, intense fight, but they're always like picking at each other for something. But then when I noticed when my father, rahimahullah, passed away, my mother missed him so intensely. Like, I was like, Mom, you used to fight all the time. How can you miss him now? And then she's like, you just won't understand. And I didn't understand, subhanAllah. But like deep down, even with all the fighting and nitpicking at one another, there was such a deep and intense love. Sometimes she would say, you know, I can hear his footsteps and I can feel, you know, as if he's still around, subhanAllah. But then as time went by, she too, started getting sick. So around December of 2022, she got like a really bad lung infection. Not COVID, but just a really bad lung infection, which led to pneumonia. And she never really recovered from that. And subhanAllah, when she would sleep, she would have an oxygen tank with her to facilitate it. But even then, you could tell that she was struggling to breathe. But subhanAllah, you know, my mother, rahimahullah, was on another level. Like, she was one of those ladies, she would have her Quran with her, and you'd think that this Quran had been through a war. Like, that's how torn the pages are, that's how worn out the pages are. Like, there's watermarks everywhere from the tears, you know, that she had shed while reading the Quran. The turn pages on the top, you know, they're brown, subhanAllah, due to her commitment to the Quran. And then I remember, subhanAllah, on the very day that she was passing away, if you remember from the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, the day before he passed away, he was sick the whole entire time, but then one day, the day before, he smiled, right? He smiled at the ummah and everyone thought it was okay, and Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu went to the outskirts of Medina because everything was going to be okay. So the night before, my mother had this very intense fever and we were thinking, should we take her to the hospital, should we not? And she's like, no, I just want to stay in bed. And then the next morning, alhamdulillah, the fever broke. She had energy for the first time in such a long time. And I'm like, Allahu Akbar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted her shifa. And this is probably around like 11 a.m. in the morning. And then at 1 p.m., I told her, Mom, I'm going to go take a shower. I'm going to head to the masjid for dhuhr. And inshallah, I'm going to come straight back. And I remember, as I got ready, probably around 1:30, like before I even got a chance to go to the masjid, and she's like, she called me on my cell, and she's like, Navaid, come back. And there was just silence on the phone. I'm like, Mom, is everything okay? And she's like, just come back. I go to her room, and subhanAllah, I can see that she's dozing in and out of consciousness. But she just kept on saying astaghfirullah the whole time. She kept on saying astaghfirullah the whole time, astaghfirullah the whole time. And I'm like, Mom, do we need to call the ambulance? And she's not responding to me. She's just making her istighfar the whole time. And this is where I saw, you know, I think what I experienced was seeing someone die at that time. Because her eyes started rolling behind her head. And I panicked. I called the ambulance right away. I'm like, look, you know, she's had pneumonia. She's been really, really sick. And I think we need to take her to the hospital. So the paramedics came. They took her to the hospital. And we made it to the hospital. And she's still alive. You know, subhanAllah. But you could tell she's really, really weak. And her again, she's like coming in and out of consciousness. And I'm like, Mom, just say the shahada. Say ashhadu la ilaha illallah. Say ashhadu la ilaha illallah. And she can't move anymore. But subhanAllah, it's amazing. Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to grant husnul khatimah to, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them husnul khatimah. Because the very last thing that she did was she raised her finger like this. And then her hand fell, her eyes closed, and then she passed away, rahimahullah. And that was on March 15th of 2023, just before Ramadan of last year. And subhanAllah, you know, not a day goes by except that I wish I could speak to my parents, except that I wish I could give my mom a hug, kiss her on the forehead, except that I wish, you know, I could have repaid my father and done so much khidmah for him, but that opportunity wasn't there. And this is the message that I share, you know, with people, that this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Isra, He tells us very specifically that when your parents grow older, one of them or both of them, فَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا, like, don't rebuke them, don't be harsh with them, but rather lower the wing of mercy upon them. Lower the wing of mercy, be kind and be merciful and be gentle with them. And then the dua that he teaches is so befitting, right? وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا, that, oh Allah, show mercy to them just like they showed mercy to me when I was a child. And we don't realize this, but as you grow older, you become more like a child, right? You're not able to critically think. You're not able to articulate what you feel. You need help walking. You need help going to the bathroom. And you pretty much reverse at that time. And just like we show mercy to children, we're so kind to them and we're so patient with them, we need to have even more patience with our parents. And this is where, subhanAllah, you know, we don't reflect on this enough, but the greatest gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us after Islam is time. Time is the greatest gift. Because you may have messed up as a young kid. Remember, as a young kid, you know, all rebellious, thinking we're cool and macho in front of our parents, not realizing the real maqam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them. Only when you become a parent yourself do you realize that, right? And then when you realize it, it's often too late. What I share with you is this very story that, subhanAllah, from someone that wishes that they had their parents alive, if you do cherish them, do as much khidmah of them as you can. They are your source of barakah. And if you look at the story of Musa alayhi salam, you know, how does Musa alayhi salam become the Kalim of Allah? How does he become the Ulul Azam? How does he become this great prophet? There was nothing other than the dua of his mother for him. Right? That's why she's such an integral component of this story. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically mentions that her heart became farigh. And he tells her, وَلَا تَحْزَنِي, right? That don't worry, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take care of him. And this is like the role that our mothers play in all of our lives. Like any success we have, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us through the dua of our mothers. And if you want success in this life, it comes through your obedience to them. You know, it's very, very profound in Al-Adab Al-Mufrad by Imam Al-Bukhari, the story of Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. He's at Hajj, and a man comes to him, all bragging and all proud. And he says, Ya Abu Abdurrahman, I've carried my mother from Yemen to perform Hajj on my shoulders. Have I repaid my debt to her? And he's expecting Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhuma. He's like, yo, that's amazing. You've earned your Jannah. Allahu Akbar, you're set, bro. And Abdullah bin Umar, he looks him in the eye and just crushes him with one line. He says you haven't even repaid the pain of one of the contractions that she felt when she was carrying you. Like, how humbling is that? This guy carried his mom for Hajj from Yemen on his shoulders, and he didn't even repay one of the pains of contractions that she felt. You know, if you look at the story in Abu Dawud behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that you and your wealth belong to your father, a very, very touching story, subhanAllah, that a man and his father came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for arbitration. And as they're coming to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for arbitration, the old man, he's crying, he has tears in his eyes, but he's thinking of these lines of poetry in his head. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's approached by Jibreel alayhi salam, and Jibreel tells him that when this old man comes to you, ask him to recite the lines of poetry that he was thinking. So the father and the son, they approach the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the son starts complaining to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, "Ya Rasulullah, he lives with me, he eats all of my food, he never leaves any food behind, he leaves the whole place a mess, he doesn't clean up after him, he's always calling me to do things for him." And the father is just crying and crying the whole time. The Prophet asks him, "Now why are you crying?" And he tells him that, "Look, I dedicated my whole entire life to my son, everything that I had, now I pretty much invested in him, now I'm old, I have no one to take care of me, and this is the way that he treats me." And the Prophet ﷺ asked him at that time, "On your way here, you were reciting verses of poetry in your head, what were you saying?" The summary of which, he was basically saying that you dedicate your whole life to something, you sacrifice everything for your children, but what do you get at the end of your life? And the son, he started crying at this, subhanAllah. He didn't realize that this is how his father had felt. Maybe they didn't speak, maybe it never clicked in his mind. But that is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tells us that you and your wealth belong to your father. You and your wealth belong to your father. And subhanAllah, you study the fiqh behind the hadith. Like, did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mean this in a literal sense? Do we as physical property and our wealth physically belong to our parents? No, not at all. That's not the point of the hadith. The point of the hadith is the mindset of the child should be that me and all of my wealth belong to my father. Like, I should be willing to give it to them, because without my father, this would not exist. I would not come into existence if my father was not there. And the sad reality is that you're not taught any of this in the culture that we live in, right? In the culture that we live in, be free as much as you can. Be as individualistic as much as you can. If you don't look after yourself, no one will look after you. And that's what we're trained in our schools. And that is why, when your parents grow older, you don't need to take care of them. Put them in a senior citizen home, let them take care of themselves. And this is what the culture teaches us. But from our perspective, is there a bigger bigharati that you can do? I ask you this sincerely, a bigger bigharati that you put your parents in a senior citizen home? There isn't, right? There's nothing more uncivilized that I can think of, that the people that sacrificed everything for you, everything, right? From your mother to all the pains that she went through, the sleepless nights, the dirty diapers, all the destructive behavior that you had, all of the disobedience that you showed her growing up, and then you don't even have the humility and the kindness to take care of them when they need you the most. Like, what could be more inhumane than that, subhanAllah? And this is where I think it's so important that, you know, there's regular tarbiyah classes in our community. Because you're not going to get this in school. You're going to learn the exact opposite. And going back to that initial point, you know, if you viewed your parents as your middle gate of Jannah, all the time. Remember, there's a tissue box here. If you viewed your parents as your middle gate of Jannah all the time, like literally when you see them, all you see is like a gate of Jannah, how would that change your relationship? I think that's the shift in the mindset that we need. Let me share this with you as we conclude this first topic. You know, a man came to the Prophet and he says, "Ya Rasulullah, I want to go on an expedition with you. I want to go out on a journey with you." He asks him, "Are both of your parents alive?" And he says, "Yes." The Prophet says, "Fafihima fajahid. Fafihima fajahid." That go and perform your jihad and serving your parents. That is where your jihad is. Why is it called a jihad? Like, jihad is meant to be something that you struggle with. Right, but if you're viewing it as a middle gate of Jannah, where's the struggle in that? The human condition is that we only value things truly after they're gone. That is how we truly value things. And subhanAllah, I remember, you know, being away from my mother, rahimahullah, when I was in Calgary and she was in Montreal. She would call me up and she's like, "Hey Navaid, there's a blue screen on the laptop, what do I do?" Or, "Hey Navaid, you know, the laptop's frozen. The iPad's frozen, sound's not coming out, what do I do?" And I'd be driving in the car, I'd be in the middle of a counseling session, I'd be doing something else. I'd be like, "Mom, we have this conversation so many times." And subhanAllah, the ignorance of man, we think that perhaps our parents are jahil, they don't know how to do these things and that's why they keep calling. But only to later realize that she kept calling because she wanted a reason to call just to hear my voice. But in my head, I'm thinking, "La ilaha illallah." Like, how many times am I going to teach you this? In my head, that's what I'm thinking. But little did I know that this was meant to be my jihad. That I'm supposed to be patient, just like they were patient with me. I didn't learn to walk by myself. They taught me how to walk. I didn't learn how to speak. They taught me how to speak. I didn't know how to read and write. They taught me how to read and write. The level of patience that was needed for that. And then you have a generation that was raised without technology and now they're exposed to technology and they don't know how to use it and you get frustrated, you get angry with them? How dare we? How dare we? This is your jihad. This is why the Prophet says, "Fafihima fajahid." You want to go and fight out on the battlefield? Forget that. If you can't even take care of your parents with love and respect, what are you going to do on the battlefield? You're not going to do anything on the battlefield. Go and take care of your parents. And this is what I think, subhanAllah. You know, the du'as that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserves in the Qur'an, millions, billions, maybe even trillions of du'as have been made throughout history, right? Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses to preserve some of them in the Qur'an for us, out of the deep, profound meanings, and out of the love that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has for those du'as, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserved them. And one of the du'as that Ibrahim alayhi salam made, "Rabbi ja'alni muqima as-salati wa min dhurriyyati. Rabbana wa taqabbal du'a. Rabbana ighfir li wa li walidayya wa lil mu'minina yawma yaqumu al-hisab." Right? "O my Lord, make me from one that establishes the prayer and from my progeny wa min dhurriyyati. Rabbana wa taqabbal du'a." That, "O Allah, respond to all of my du'as. Respond to all of my du'as. Rabbana wa taqabbal du'a. Rabbana ighfir li. That, O Allah, forgive me. Wa li walidayya. And for both of my parents. Yawma yaqumu al-hisab. On the day that accounting takes place." Now why is this such a profound du'a? Because if you look at this du'a, this is before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited Ibrahim alayhi salam from making dua for his father. Right? And you have to understand the story so deeply that his father used to be the main idol producer of his times. Like, there was no bigger mushrik. He made the idols that they used to worship. And once Ibrahim alayhi salam, he starts giving dawah, the father gets very, very upset. How upset? He takes his own son and throws him into the fire. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a command to the fire. "Kuni bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim." That be cold and cooling and peaceful to Ibrahim. Yet even then, Ibrahim alayhi salam used to seek forgiveness for his father, even though his father treated him in that manner. And this is the level of humility that a child should have. That even if you end up getting abused by your parent, it happens. I completely get that. But is a father ever beyond redemption? That if there was anyone beyond redemption, it would have been the father of Ibrahim. Number one, because he's the idol producer and the main mushrik of his time. But number two, he threw his own son into the fire. If anything, that's beyond redemption. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us such a very valuable lesson that as believers, even if our parents have treated us harshly, and perhaps there may have been some wrongs that took place, it is still our responsibility to seek forgiveness for them. It's our responsibility to seek forgiveness for them. So while they're alive, you treat them kindness, you treat them well, you're patient with them. After they pass away, you seek forgiveness for them. You do sadaqah jariyah on their behalf. Why does the Prophet ﷺ tell us that after we pass away, all of our deeds come to an end, except for three? What are the three things? What are the three things that continue even after we pass away? Sadaqah jariyah and the righteous child that makes dua for you, and ilmun yuntafa'u bih, beneficial knowledge that you leave behind. So the Prophet ﷺ tells us this to show us what a righteous child does. That not a salah goes by, not a sajda goes by, except that you are waladun salih. Right? That will seek forgiveness for their parents. And there's a very funny story. There's a sheikh in Saudi Arabia, Sheikh Muhammad Al-Arifi. He's written a lot of books. He used to be very prominent on YouTube. And he was imprisoned in the last, you know, couple of years, subhanAllah. But a man came to him and he says, Sheikh, you know, these are my children. And the sheikh asks, you know, what are your names? And he goes, I am Salih 1, Salih 2, Salih 3, Salih 4, until Salih 11. So the sheikh asks, you know, there's so many names in the Quran, so many prophets. Why did you name all of them Salih? And he says, because I heard the prophet, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, waladun salih yad'u lahu, a waladun salih yastaghfir lahu. That, you know, that the Prophet said that all of your deeds will come to an end except for a child that you have named Salih that will seek forgiveness for you. Instead of taking the interpretation that Salih means righteous, right? Except for a righteous child that will seek forgiveness for you. You know, I always laugh at that story, subhanAllah. Like the innocent mind that wants good, look at what the innocent mind is able to achieve, subhanAllah. You know, when your parents pass away, not only has that middle gate of Jannah closed, but their du'as, you know, they're no longer actively able to make du'a for you. That's not possible. And you actually feel, you know, the barakah. That's the best way I can describe it. Go away. Barakah in the time, the barakah in the money, the barakah in the health, the barakah and all that you're able to achieve. And you think to yourself, subhanAllah, nothing has changed. It's not that I've become sinful. It's not that, you know, something has happened. Where did it go? Only to realize that it is the barakah from your parents. And I think there's a very big wisdom behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling us to recite Surah Al-Kahf every single week on the day of Friday. Because in it is a beautiful story of the two children that have that treasure, right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserved that treasure for them till they got older. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the very reason when Musa alayhi salam, you know, questions Khidr. He says, وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا, that their father was a righteous man. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefited the children through the righteousness of the parents. And the children, they wouldn't understand that. They wouldn't know that this treasure was preserved for them because their father was a righteous man. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us that valuable lesson. That if there's an element of barakah missing in your life, reassess your relationship with your parents. Right? If things aren't going the way that you want, reassess your relationship with your parents. There is a reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so many times in the Quran affiliates our right and responsibility, rather, our responsibility to Allah and our responsibility to our parents. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّهِ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And how many times do we hear this? That your Lord has commanded and ordained that you worship none other than Allah and you do righteousness for your parents. In Surah Luqman, what do we see? That we should be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to our parents paired together. Now that is the maqam that our parents have. And as you grow older, I'm speaking particularly your young teens, your early 20s, you want autonomy, you want freedom, you want to get married, you want to move on with your life, and you think that this is your right to do so. And Islamically, you're correct. You have the right to get married and to move on with your life, but not at the expense or at the neglect of your parents, right? As male children, particularly, you have a greater responsibility to your parents than your sisters do. And this is a responsibility that you carry with pride, right? It is our pride to serve our parents. It is our pride to take care of them to the best of our ability. It is our pride that we provide for them and give them. SubhanAllah. You know, I remember watching this video recently where the Sheikh was asked, "Ya Sheikh, can I give zakat to my parents?" And the Sheikh just started crying. And he's like, "Is this what has happened to our people? That people that we're responsible for, we're supposed to give them freely, take whatever you want, that we're now asking, can I give zakat to my parents? Your parents should never be in that position in the first place that you should be asking. Give them freely." Right? Like, you want more money? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you whatever you want if you take care of your parents. You want barakah in your wealth? Allah will increase the barakah, but take care of your parents. All of that is deeply, deeply tied to our parents. You know, in my mind, I thought, subhanAllah, I'd have a lot more time. And I wanted to speak about the spousal relationship as well. But I feel I've reached my limit of 30 minutes, inshallah. So I'll leave the rest of the time for questions and answers. And inshallah, in the future gathering, I'll speak about the rights and responsibilities between spouses. Allahu ta'ala alam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us for our sins. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us righteous and obedient children towards our parents. Those of us whose parents have passed away, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon them, forgive them, and grant them Jannat al-Firdaus, and make their reckoning an easy one, and make their graves a garden from the gardens of paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us for any shortcomings that we've had towards our parents. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not hold us accountable for our sins and for our mistakes, particularly with regards towards our parents. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite us and our parents and our children and all of our loved ones in Jannat al-Firdaus with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. اللهم آمين وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Well, if anyone has any questions, we can take some questions. No. that lecture, in no exaggeration, it goes more in favor of the wives than it does for the husbands. So that's why I think for another time, inshallah, for another time. Because in order to do it justice, it'll take time. And I know people have been here all night praying. We are in the last 10 nights, so we should spend some more time doing some more ibadah and stuff. One favorite advice, I would say, don't treat your spouses the way you want to be treated. And what I mean by that is men and women, we're very, very different. وَلَيْسَ ذَكَرُ كَالْأُنْثَى. The way we talk is very different. Men, straight to the point, just tell me what you want, right? Women will tell you the whole day, everything that happened to their friend, everything that happened to their relatives, and then she'll tell you, oh, by the way, can you pick up some milk from the store? Exactly. And she'll ask you, did you hear me or not? Right? Repeat everything I just said. But what we fail to realize is that this is not a deficiency in the women, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them like this because this is how they build their bonds, this is how they build their affinity. This is how, you know, when they're with their friends at their homes, they need something to talk about, right? So the way they communicate is very, very different. The way they handle stress, very, very different. Man wants to be by himself, needs time to decompress. You know, I like to tell this story, subhanAllah. A man comes home from work, he finds his wife at home, she's crying, and he thinks to himself, you know what, when I'm upset, I just want to be left alone. So he comes inside, says, Assalamu alaikum, goes upstairs, goes to his room, and the wife's like, what an inconsiderate husband, who did I marry? And then, similar scenario, husband comes home, clearly he's frustrated and distraught, and the wife comes up to him and she says, you know what, let me treat him the way I like to be treated. And she puts her arm around him and she's like, talk to me about your feelings. How are you feeling? And the guy's like, just leave me alone. I don't want to be around you. Right? So the way we handle stress is very, very different. So I know there's a component of Islam that says, you know, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. That none of us will truly believe till we love for others, you know, what we love for ourselves. But you don't take that literally. Right? You love for people what is best for them and what they desire and what they want, right? And oftentimes, because alhamdulillah, I think a lot of us, we come from conservative families, we went to madrasa, we went to Islamic schools, we didn't interact with the opposite gender much, so we don't understand the drastic differences that take place. So then you end up getting married and you end up treating your spouse the way you would treat one of the guys, and that's not the way it's meant to be, right? It's meant to be a completely different relationship. To understand the psychological differences, understand the communication differences, understand the different responses that we have to stress and to anxiety, understand that, you know, one gender is more goal-oriented, one gender is more process-oriented, and when you're dealing with your spouse, you have to come with that mindset of being process-oriented. It's not just about the goal, but it is about the process, right? So that, along with the biggest thing of being, you know, having taqwa and righteousness in the household, that's paramount, that's at the forefront of all things. But on a practical level, that's what I would say is the one piece of advice I would give to spouses. Don't treat them like yourselves. Allahu ta'ala. Go ahead. Correct. Sure. Yeah. إنك لا تهدي من أحبب. Of course. So I think let's address these questions separately. Firstly, dealing with non-Muslim parents. What is our responsibility towards them? Right? The responsibility towards non-Muslim parents are exactly the same as towards Muslim parents. Being kind to them, being righteous to them, being in their service as much as you possibly can. And I think as a convert, that's very, very important, because a lot of times there is this negative perception of what Muslims do and what Muslims are, all barbaric, all terrorists, all harsh and evil, right? So that khidmah component, that servitude component is very, very important, and righteousness is very important. Number two, the importance of making dua for them, making as much dua as you possibly can, and you never know when they accept Islam, right? We have the example of Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, you know, gave dawah actively for his mom until, you know, one day he basically gave up. But then he goes to the Prophet ﷺ, he says, Ya Rasulullah, make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides her. He goes home and she says, don't come in. I've just, you know, finished taking ghusl from becoming Muslim, right? And this is, you know, that turbulent relationship that a non-Muslim parent may have with their convert child. So continuously make dua for them and ask righteous people to make dua for them as well. I think the defining line though is two things. While they're alive, if that relationship starts affecting your iman, where they're constantly like saying bad things about the Prophet ﷺ or saying bad things about Islam, then you have to create a boundary. And You know, recharge your battery, approach again. Recharge your battery, approach again. But don't just keep going back with an empty battery, because it's going to make that situation so much worse. So that's while they're alive. And the other, you know, red line is after they pass away. And after they pass away, there is no making dua for them after that. Right? You can't seek forgiveness for them. You can't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy upon them. And then let that pain of not being able to do that after they pass away be a driving force in you trying even harder to give them dawah and be a righteous son to them and be, you know, continuously making dua for them. Now, at the end of the day, if you've done all of this and you've tried your best and your parent is still a disbeliever, then you have a beautiful example in Ibrahim alayhi salam, who was the Khalil of Allah, right, the close intimate friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and even then his father was a non-Muslim. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us that upon you is to make the effort. At the end of the day, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who guides whomever He pleases. Whomever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deems fit to be guided, will be guided. And whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deems fit not to be guided, will not be guided, no matter what we do, no matter how much effort we put into it, right? So be effort-oriented, not goal-oriented. The effort is in your hands, the goal is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't conflate the two. Now, with regards to the abusive parent, I think there's multiple scenarios. Scenario number one is those that were abusive towards their children growing up and are no longer abusive when they grow older. You have like a traumatic experience that you're trying to heal from and you're wounded from. In these sort of situations, I think this is actually a positive scenario where through counseling and through therapy, you can work through your trauma and work through your pain and use that as an opportunity to reconcile with your parents and hopefully express to them in the best and kindest of ways what they did was wrong and no child should be treated like that, and then help them make tawbah, help them seek forgiveness with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then you have a second scenario, which is, you know, they're troublesome till this day, where they're abusive till this day, and even now they continue to abuse you, right? And in this sort of situation, I would say the same thing has to be applied, where you set a boundary, recharge, re-engage. Set a boundary, recharge, re-engage. And the goal over here is that before they die, they make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just like we wanted someone to accept Islam, the same goal over here, we want them to make tawbah before they pass away. And that is the ultimate goal that we have to get through. So try your best to be righteous, try your best to lead by example, try your best to share positive stories of what parenting is supposed to be like, make dua for them. And by no means does forgiveness in Islam mean that you let go of the pain. That's not in your control, right? That only happens over long periods of times of counseling and therapy. But what we are obliged to do, particularly with our parents, is that we don't want them held accountable in the hereafter. Like if your parents are Muslim, you don't want them to be punished in the hereafter, no matter what they've done to you, right? At the end of the day, we don't want the hellfire for anyone. We don't hold them liable and accountable in our hearts on the Day of Judgment. And that is why we want to rekindle that relationship and fix that relation to the degree that they make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before they meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Right? Yeah, that's a tough one, subhanAllah. Of course. So the first thing I would highlight is that never assume that life is going to be easy. Like if you're living a comfortable life, you're doing something wrong. The believer's life is meant to be filled with challenges, and you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help to navigate through those challenges. This is what all the lives of the prophets were, right? So that's what you need to figure out, is that now, how do I balance between the two? So you have a primary responsibility in terms of being the provider and the protector for your wife and kids. That is your responsibility. That is a fard ayn upon you. Oh, got you. That is correct. So, no, I'll just repeat it, inshallah. I'll just repeat it. I apologize to the sister, subhanAllah. That is a mistake. Please forgive me. The brother's current question that we're answering right now is, what advice do I have for brothers that are navigating the relationship between their wives and their mothers? Like, how do they balance that relationship? And I started off by mentioning that this relationship isn't meant to be easy, and you're constantly meant to be seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help in navigating this relationship. So the first thing we need to look at is, how do we break down, fiqh-wise, where our obligations lie? So in terms of taking care of your wife and kids, this is a fard ayn that you have to do. In terms of taking care of your parents, it is a fard kifaya between all of the children, between all of the children. And the child that does the most will have the greatest amount of ajr and the greatest stance with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? So your primary responsibility is to take care of your wife and kids. And as long as your parents are being taken care of by your other siblings, then you are absolved of sin. You are absolved of sin. Now, in the scenario where you are perhaps the oldest son or the only son, that is where things become even more challenging. And this is where it's so important to have husband and wife on the same page. That you have a conversation with your wife, honey, I love you deeply. There is not a woman on this planet that I love in the way that I love you. Because the love for the mother is very different than love for the wife. This is a truthful statement. And tell her that at the end of the day, as many rights as you have upon me, as me being your husband, my Jannah lies under the feet of my mother. And that is a relationship you cannot compete with. So rather than trying to compete with her, how can we work together to take care of her? Right? And inshallah, whatever help you need in taking care of your parents, I'll be there to support you in that as well. Right? As practicing believers, this is the way we're meant to approach it, where both of us are on the same page. So what that means is creating some sort of structure in your life where, depending on the circumstance and the situation, you know, you communicate with your spouse and tell them, look, 7 days a week, my parents, you know, perhaps let's see if we can live in the same house together. If that's not feasible, let's try to get them a house close by so that I can move back and forth. And yeah, it's going to be a struggle. You're going to be running back and forth all the time, but this is where your ajr is. This is your gate to Jannah. This is where you keep yourself motivated, right? You spend upon them freely, just like you would spend freely upon your wife and kids. And this is where I think, as men, we have this particular struggle. We're very, very money-oriented, right? We're fixated with money. More money, more money, more money, more money. But in this chase for more money, we realize that the point isn't having more money, it's about having more barakah in our money. That's what you need, right? And if you freely spend on your parents and you freely spend on your wife and kids, there will be an immense amount of barakah that you'll be able to survive freely. But as soon as you get greedy, as soon as you become stingy, and you're not spending on your parents, and you're not spending on your wife and kids, and you're just seeing these dollar signs in your bank account, that's where no one will be happy with you. Not your parents, not your wife and kids, and most importantly, not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? So you have to change that mindset. Be free with your money, with your parents, and with your wife and kids, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you more. Number three is even having a conversation with the parents. How can I best serve you? What is the thing that you need the most from me? Right? And having this deep conversation with them, because oftentimes you may think, I need to cook for my parents, I need to clean for my parents. But at the end of the day, all your parents want is for you to come and talk with them for 15, 20 minutes every single night, and they'll be happy. They can still cook, they can still clean and take care of their house. You're doing all this work that they don't want from you in the first place, but it could have been avoided if you just communicated with them. So I would say that is what I would add, along to constantly asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help and for guidance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Brother in the back. A few questions from the sister side, okay. For parents, for reverts whose parents are non-Muslims, are they reunited in Jannah as well? So I would say there's two scenarios over here. Scenario number one is very, very clear. Then inshallah, if they accept Islam, they will be reunited in Jannah. No doubt about that. Scenario number two is not as clear. And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ultimate judge. But if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides that the true message of Islam did not reach them, then even though they would die as non-believers in this life, in the hereafter Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would test them, and a prophet would be sent to them, and if they follow that prophet, they would be entered into Jannah at that time. But this is with the condition that the true message of Islam did not reach them. But then what that makes me understand is that if the true message of Islam did not reach them, you didn't do your job properly as a child. Which only technically leaves scenario number one, which you make dua for them, you be that righteous child, you be in their service, and you keep having the conversations that need to be had to get them to become Muslim. And I think the worrying point over here is, you know, will I be sad in Jannah because my parents are not there? And I don't know how Jannah works. This is from the ilm al-ghayb. But I have full faith in the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He says, وَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. There will be no fear and there will be no sadness in Jannah. So this is a fear that we have in this world that is not real in the hereafter. Wallahu ta'ala anam. Yeah. How do you raise children to be righteous? That can be lecture number three. Lecture number two is about the first lecture, number three is about the children. But very quickly, number one, make dua for them. Number two, lead by example. Number three, use affiliation of positive emotions with your children. Like, never punish your children by telling them to go and read Quran. Never punish your children by telling them, go and pray. Right? You create these negative emotions for your child with them. And then number four, never have contradictory parenting, where you tell your child to do something, but you're not doing it yourself. Don't tell them to pray if you're not praying. Don't tell them not to smoke if you're going to be smoking. Right? That creates a contradiction in their mind, which eventually leads to a resentment of the faith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Sorry, start over again. Praying for her son, yeah. Uh-huh. Okay. So the sister's question is about having a child that has a substance abuse issue. He's not financially independent. He has gone for Umrah and she does not see her du'as being answered. So this is going to be a bit of a longer answer. But firstly, let's start off with, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make things easy for you and guide your son and help him with his substance abuse issue and rectify the relationship between the two of you. Allahumma ameen. Number two is understanding how dua works. Right? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was encouraging the companions to make dua, to increase in dua, and he tells them that all of your du'as will be answered in one of three ways. Either you get what you want when you want it, or that it's delayed till a time that it's better for you, or what you're asking for is not good for you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala averts an equal amount of evil from your life. And they said, Ya Rasulullah, if this is the case, we will only increase in our dua. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Wallahu akthar. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has even more to give you in terms of the more dua that you make. So the way the du'as are answered is in these three ways. And I want to reflect on all of these. Allah gives you what you want when you want it. Now this is the ideal case scenario that all of us want. Oh Allah, I want a Ferrari. When I leave the masjid, there should be a Ferrari waiting for me outside. But Ibn Ata'illah, he says something so beautiful and so profound. He says, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you what you wanted, when you wanted it, who would be the master and who would be the slave? And I think this is so important to remember, that when we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to us, it's not a result of a righteousness that we have, it's not a result of a debt that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala owes us, it is purely out of the generosity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala owes us nothing. He owes us nothing. So if He gives us, it's out of His kindness and His generosity. So we should get rid of this mindset, I have to have it right here, right now. If it happens, alhamdulillah. If it doesn't happen, alhamdulillah. Inna lillahi ma akhadh wa lahu ma ata. Belongs to Allah is that which He gave, belongs to Allah is that which He took. Scenario number two is that you get what you want, at a time that it is better for you. So I give the example of a brother. He's been looking for work for a very long time. He has elderly parents, he has a wife and young kids, he has responsibilities to the masjid, and he's never learned to manage his time. And he keeps making dua that, "Oh Allah, grant me a job, oh Allah, grant me a job." And subhanAllah, sometime later, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants him the job. He's like, "Allahu Akbar, you know, what changed in my life? Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answer me now?" And he realizes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had taught him how to manage his time and to balance all of his responsibilities before he gave him the job. Because if he got the job before he learned how to balance his time and manage his time, everything would have been a disaster. But he had to wait a little while longer before he learned what he had to learn, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered him. Or number three, what he's asking for is in fact not good for him. And we have an example in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that a woman came to him and she said, "Ya Rasulullah, I suffer from epilepsy. Make dua for me that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes it away from me." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tells her that if you were to be patient, that is better for you. Right? Be patient and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you Jannah. So she says, "Ya Rasulullah, if that is the case, I will accept that, but make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't expose my awrah when I have these epileptic seizures." And he made dua, and her awrah was not exposed thereafter. So what we don't realize is sometimes the hardships and calamities that we're going through, they are the cause that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mercy upon us and enters us into Jannah. And just like we view our parents as the middle gate of Jannah, view this relationship that inshallah, if I'm patient enough, if I work hard enough, if I continue to make dua, and I keep, you know, working towards this, as long as you're not being physically, emotionally, psychologically abused, keep working towards it, right? This is, inshallah, your way to get your ajr. Being forgiven for your sins, your good deeds are being written down for you, your ranks in Jannah are being raised. What more could you want? You show up on the Day of Judgment with mountains of reward, right? And that's, you know, Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah, he has a very profound passage where he speaks about people that will show up on the Day of Judgment and their du'as weren't answered. And he says that even though this hasn't happened in humanity as we know it, that there wasn't a creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never answered any of their du'as, but he says in the hypothetical case that there was, these people will show up on the Day of Judgment and they will have mountains of reward and they will say, "Oh Allah, we don't remember the good deeds that we did that got us the mountains of these rewards." And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell them that these are the rewards for the patience that you showed when you thought your du'as were not answered. You thought your du'as were not answered. And these people will say, "We wish none of our du'as were ever answered. We wish none of our du'as were ever answered." So keep striving, keep pushing, keep trying your best. And that is all Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you. Allahu ta'ala anu. Inshallah, I'm going to take two last questions. One from my uncle over here, and then one from you over there, bithinahi ta'ala. Wa alaikum as-salam. After becoming adults. So the question is, after your children become adults and they have financial burdens, can zakat be given to them? Can zakat be given to them? And from what I remember of this scenario, the answer is yes. Zakat can be given to the children with the condition that the parents aren't benefiting from this in any way. As long as the parents are not benefiting from giving zakat to their children, then it is allowed to do so. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Well, the general rule when giving zakat is that it shouldn't be mentioned. You just learn about their circumstance and their situation, and you give them the help. Because if you tell them that this zakat, it's going to make them feel worse. Yeah. Oh, yeah, no problem. Excellent. The brother's question is, for those that are studying in different cities, How can we fulfill our responsibility towards our parents? The first thing that I would look at is, if you have siblings, then collectively you need to come up with a plan to take care of your parents and what that looks like. But if, again, you're the oldest male sibling or the only male sibling, then that's a different scenario. And at that point, you have to make a conscious decision, which is, you know, what am I going to pursue more? Either my education or my career, or be with my parents. In an ideal situation, your parents are still relatively young and relatively healthy and in good condition, and you have a conversation with them and come up with a plan with them. That, look, mom and dad, inshallah, I'm going to go and study for 4 years. And I'm going to keep coming back every break. I'm going to call you every day. You will FaceTime. We'll do all of this stuff. And inshallah, if there's ever an emergency, I'll come back right away. And I'll still, you know, come back for Eid and for all of the holidays and all of that. And if your parents are okay with that, alhamdulillah, you know, you've created a scenario that I would consider a win-win situation. The difficult scenario starts when your parents start getting older and they're unable to take care of themselves, or if one of them becomes sick and, you know, there's no one to take care of them. And at that point, I think the difficult decision that needs to be made, as hard as it is, putting your studies aside and dedicating your time to your parents. Because at the end of the day, what we're trying to do with our education is to get a job, to get money, to spend that money in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to get to Jannah. That is what the goal is. But not everyone will have that linear trajectory in getting to Jannah. Sometimes you will have to sacrifice your career, you'll have to sacrifice your education to be the primary caretaker for your parents. And in my experience, you know, the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are so true. Man taraka shay'an lillah, awwada Allahu ahsana min. That whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always replaces it with something better. That I've never seen anyone that sincerely left something for the sake of Allah, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them so much more and so much better. Right? So whatever fear a person may have in sacrificing their education or sacrificing their career, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is generous and kind, and He will never shortchange His slaves and His worshippers. So even at the forefront, there may be some pain, a bitterness, but as you see the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unfold, everything that you had desired by taking that other path, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you so much more. This is the hadith that I'll conclude with. You know, it's been the hadith that's been on my mind, I would say, for the last 8 weeks or so, where Imam At-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah report that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna rabbakum ayyun karimun yastahi min 'abdihi idh rafa'a yadayhi ayaruddahuma khaibatayn aw sifara." Or كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. That he sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Your Lord is the most shy and is the most generous. And He becomes even more shy when the slave raises their hands to Allah, that Allah should leave the hands empty-handed without having given that which the slave asked for." You know, this is the Lord that we're dealing with. He is bashful and He is generous. And He becomes even more bashful when the slave raises their hands to Allah. Our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes shy of us when we raise our hands, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like, how do you think you will ever be shortchanged? How do you think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not give you better? How do you think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not take care of you? When you have a Lord that is described with these characteristics, inna rabbakum, your Lord, is the most bashful and is the most generous. And He becomes even more bashful when you raise your hands. So the mistake is we're not raising our hands enough. The flaw is not in Allah, the flaw is in us. Raise your hands more, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you more. Allahu Akbar. It's for all of us, it's not just me. For all of us, right? Like I always tell myself and all of us, if we turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and raised our hands when things are good for us and easy for us and we're living in prosperity, just as we did when things are difficult, you know, we would be living a completely different reality. But the thing is, we only raise our hands to Allah when we are desperate. When things are going bad, when things are tough, we raise our hands to Allah. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us that very few of my slaves are grateful. Very few of my slaves are grateful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from the grateful. Allahumma ameen. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك جزاكم الله خيرا for your attention. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بارك الله. I apologize, I went way over time, man. I'm so sorry.
No worries at all. Jazakallah khair, Sheikh Navaid, for taking the time out this late at night to enlighten us with your words, and for coming all the way from Calgary to share his words of wisdom with us. And also jazakallah khair to all of you brothers and sisters for again staying this late to participating in this lecture. Just a couple of announcements, just a reminder, inshallah, on Monday after the Dhuhr around 2 o'clock, we'll be having Salat al-Kusuf, which is the Salah for Eclipse, with Qari Yunus, as well as a talk with Mufti Yusuf Wadat. So inshallah, we encourage everyone to participate. Also, make sure you follow us on our Instagram pages, Islamic Foundation of Toronto and IFT Youth, for all our latest updates for events and everything that's happening in the masjid. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.